As it relates to the topic of structure and leadership, understand that many of you, your firms, are going from a small firm to a large firm. And when I say large, you could be going from 5 to 15 million. That's large, okay? You could be going from 3 to 10 to 6. That's large. The reason this is important, and you could be going from single to multiple markets, and the reason it's important is that governance and structure changes need to be made as we grow. The way we did it as a $3 million firm may not work as a $10 million firm. Or the way we did it as a 50 will not work as a 250, $250 million firm. So you have to, there's a lot of change that you're going through. And the mistake a lot of firms make is they don't adapt to those changes and they're trying to do it the way we used to do it. And we get in trouble that way. More corporate, typically when you get larger, more corporate is natural. Now I'm not talking all the way to the end of the scale as it relates to corporate, but I am talking somewhere in the middle because you have to have it for more efficiency and so on. And my point here is build now for future growth. If your strat plan says we're going to double in 5 to 10 years, which is common, the way things are going these days, then we need to build our governance model for that. Silos, as it relates to firm structure, there's a lot of silos out there. They create the we versus they dynamic. And it's an inhibitor to growth. Here's what I would do. Build the business case. Help the CEO with this. By building a business case that if we weren't siloed in either these service niches, these industry niches, or these office niches, whatever they are, if we weren't siloed, we would be a larger firm. We would be better developing people. We would be better off for it. We need partner buy-in to do this, though, because typically the partners are driving the silos. And truthfully, the compensation system drives the partners to drive the silos. And there's not much you can do directly to impact the comp system, but be aware of it. That's why typically we have silos, is because they're getting paid for whatever the metrics are that they're developing by being in a silo. Think about that. That's not the one firm concept. We need systematic dilutions of our silos. Believe me, or your firm will be inhibited in growth. That's the key. It's a growth strategy to blow up the silos. As it relates to clients, here's a real quick graphic of what I think the firm, or at least some dynamics of the firm of the future. And I'm going to break it down to what I call old legacy, new legacy. The old legacy is we've got a lot of boomers in the profession. And our clients, a lot of our clients are boomers. Nothing wrong with that, I am one. I get it. The new legacy firm is Gen X, Y, Z. So, and I'm not a generational specialist, but I know enough, you know enough to know the dynamics are different. The boomers are selling, they're passing their ownerships on, they're retiring and so on, and of course the new legacy, they're buying, building, and inheriting. Here's a key point. In the next 20 years, there's a minus $30 trillion transfer of wealth from the boomers to the new legacy, if you will, the X, Y's, and the Z's. Minus $30 trillion. I'll come back to that. As it relates to old legacy, and this impacts your job directly, as it relates to old legacy, pretty much clients were forever. You had to screw something up to lose a client, in quote, the old days. Today, clients are constantly, and they should, clients are saying, show me. Where's the value? I don't want to talk about last year's value. Where's this year's value? Clients want to know, and they deserve it. That's, think about that dynamic, and I'm willing to bet you have clients in that column, and you have clients in your firm in the old legacy column. And those old legacy clients have been around, they've stayed, they're loyal to a fault. They're 20 and 30 year relationship people, clients. They've been around, sometimes 40. Now, I'm getting partners telling me, this is not for me, this is from partners telling me this in retreats. They're now seeing clients rotate out after 3 to 6 years. Because they're looking for value added, they're looking for fresh views, and we're not demonstrating to them the show me, if you will. And they're not as tolerant as they used to be. So as you think about this dynamic, how does this impact your marketing strategy, your growth strategy in your firms? So the key here, the challenge is, this transfer of $30 trillion over the next 20 years, your challenge is, what is our plan to keep out what we have? Because we're having owners transfer out, how do we keep the new owners? Sometimes that's impossible. And how do we get new ones? That's the challenge in your growth plan, or one of the challenges in your growth plan, is how do we keep and how do we get, if you think about it. Because it's happening in your firms. You all have clients that are rotating out in one way or the other, selling or passing on, whatever way. As it relates to clients, in many firms, 80% of firm profits come from 20% of the clients. So you think about that, and typically what happens is we're not spending even anything near 80% of our resources toward those clients. Think about what we should be doing for those clients, those 20% clients that are driving the profitability of our firm. There's a lot of dynamics to that. There's no black and white answers, but think about it in your firm. It may not be 80-20. But have that dialogue with your managing partner or CEO. And they may not know. I mean, it's hard to calculate, but you can estimate who's really driving profit, which clients are driving profitability. So here's what I would do. Definitive plan for each of those clients, each of those 20% bucket clients, or whatever you call your key clients. You may call them the A clients. A definitive plan for each one of them. Quarterly ownership touch at a minimum. Ownership with our partners. We have to show depth and expertise or we're not going to keep that client long. Because they deserve it and the other firms, your competition, are demonstrating it. We need to be more proactive as a profession and we need to anticipate client needs more than we do. It's a generality, I know. And we need to ask more. We cannot be serving those clients by sitting at our desks. We need to be out there with them, whatever that means in the context of your firm. The ultimate client service plan. Here's what I would do. For all A and B clients, develop a profile plan to ultimately deliver client service. Include these following elements. You may have others. Understanding the needs. Recognizing the service needs that they have, consistent communications with those clients, and a designated relationship partner and key staff assigned to those clients. Those A and B clients deserve consistency. And many firms, especially the largest firms, we've heard this forever, the Big Four, Big Six, Big Eight, they're constantly rotating people in, and the clients hate it. Whatever else you want to put in your ultimate client service plan. For the top 100 clients, here's a best practice that I picked up along the way, a firm I work with. For their top 100 clients, here's what they do. They have record of the track time, obviously, that they spend on that client, both billable and non-billable. But they have another category called non-tracked efforts. We don't record the time on this, but we think about these clients a lot. We may be at a CPE session thinking about this certain tax strategy that impacts client A. This firm keeps track of that because that's value if you think about it. We're not going to bill for that particular untracked. But it shows the client A we're thinking about them. It shows the client that they're on our A and B list and that we value them. And this firm reviews that both tracked and non-tracked time with the clients on an annual basis. So that's a best practice for whatever it's worth.